County Courthouse in Flint, Michigan. Four teenagers have pled guilty to manslaughter in the death of 32-year-old Kenneth White. A fifth defendant, 19-year-old Kyle Anger, has already pled guilty as an adult to second-degree murder. The teens threw a 6-pound rock off a highway overpass, puncturing the windshield of a passing car, striking White in the head. The driver, Stephen Anther, seeing his friend injured, immediately called 911 for help. White, a father of four, engaged to be married, died shortly afterwards at the hospital. The four defendants all agreed to plead guilty to manslaughter with one stipulation: that they be tried as juveniles, not adults. Judge Joseph Farah is tasked with accepting or rejecting that stipulation. As Judge Farah weighs his decision, several factors work against the teens, including the fact that for these boys, dropping objects from overpasses was apparently a regular pastime.
But they think it's funny, though, and it really wasn't funny.
Was it done at a single location? The rocks and other items were gathered from other locations, loaded in a truck, and then driven to overpasses to throw them over. Also thrown at other times and other locations. Tire irons, a muffler, a shopping cart. A shopping cart. A couch. What was the purpose in this game called overpassing?
Excuse me, pardon.
Stop. When somebody was killed.
Additionally, the teens made light of the horrific crime through dozens of heartless Snapchat messages.
51 times the letters LOL, LMAO, or ha-ha appear in the messages, and many after it was learned that they had killed somebody. Lay low for a while and everything will be fine. Only way you get in trouble is if a and I won't say the word, spelled rats, so you better hope he didn't give in already, or else we're going to the slammer.
As Kenneth White's grieving mother watches from the gallery, Judge Farah announces his decision.
The proposal for juvenile sentencing is rejected.
Once that decision is issued, the four defendants withdraw their guilty plea and choose to go to trial. While awaiting trial, three of the teens remain in custody without bond, while a fourth, Alexander Miller, is out on $25,000 bond. As for the fifth defendant, Kyle Anger, who's already pled guilty to second-degree murder, he begins serving his sentence of 39 months to 20 years in a Michigan state prison.
They were all in it together. All of them. Equal fall.
Next, we head to the S. James Foxman Justice Center in Daytona Beach, Florida.
We are ready to go for us. All right, Ms. Cook, come on.
I heard about her. I remember watching a DJ Ghosty at you now. I heard in our Marcy video about that from her. About her.
Robbery that ended with another teen being shot. The teen survived. Cook has accepted a plea deal that will drop a conspiracy charge, which carried a maximum penalty of life in prison. But counts of carjacking, attempted carjacking with a deadly weapon, and felony battery are still in play.
All right, come on up, Ms. Cook. You get to say the final words.
I just want to say that I'm sorry to the mom that her son had been shot, because I didn't even know he was going to get shot. My boyfriend and his friends did threaten me to do this. I didn't even know what was going on until I was at the wrong place at the wrong time. I just want to say that I asked the brother to give me this one second chance so I can get out and finish school, and I can make my mama proud, because I want to be her first child to bring home a high school diploma. And I just want to meet my own crowd. Is it?
Cook now prepares to hear her sentence as her loved ones look on.
Ms. Cook, you're before the court for sentencing. A couple of things going in your favor. One, you didn't hold a firearm during these episodes. The second is that the victim luckily survived. That being said, this was intentional. There was an orchestrated ambush, and you are a main part of that. And for that, I'm going to go ahead and adjudicate you guilty of all three charges, sentence you to 20 years in state prison.
The crying you hear is coming from Cook's mother. The sentence much more severe than they expected.
Wrong place, wrong time. Always think about what you're doing before you choose.
It turns out that Cook and her mother's reactions were so intense because they believed the plea deal meant no prison time. Judge Foxman allows her to enter a new plea deal, citing miscommunication between Cook and the assistant public defender. As a result of that new deal, Cook's sentence is reduced to 11 years in prison.
We got down to 20 to 10.
County Trial Court in Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Your Honor, my client and I have reviewed the pre-sentence report in this matter. We don't find any factual errors.
This is 17-year-old Donta Wright. Wright's in court today to receive his sentence for the shooting death of high school student Jordan Klee. He's pled guilty to armed robbery, conspiracy to commit armed robbery, a felony firearm violation, and second-degree murder. As part of the sentencing, a family member makes a victim impact statement on behalf of the victim's mother, who's too overcome with emotion to speak.
I sincerely hope that whatever it was you wanted so badly that you felt the need to murder my son was worth the next at least 52 years of your continued existence. You won't get the luxury of raising your child because you took mine away.
Wright's demeanor during this statement is not what you might expect.
Your actions have led you to a prison cell, but have also created an empty cell that I live in every day. While you can still hope to be released one day, I'll never escape my hell. You are still alive, but Jordan has no future. Thank you, Your Honor. We're done.
Wright and his attorney approach the podium.
Your Honor, my client wants to address the court.
Well, of course. Yes, sir. Mr. Wright, what would you like to say?
I just want to tell y'all, I'll be home soon. I'll be Keon. I love my family.
That's all you got to say.
No, I'm sorry to the victim?
Could have been used to show remorse to the court for his actions. It wasn't.
You know, I have never in 23 years approximately ever not accepted a sentence agreement between the parties because it's a bargain for sentence by the parties. But watching you sit there, smile, laugh and shake your head like this was no big deal, I'm very tempted to just say I'm not going to accept this sentence agreement. We'll go to trial, and if you're convicted of felony murder, you'll go to prison for the rest of your life. That means you'll die there. That's what I'm tempted to do.
The judge does have the authority to reject the plea deal.
Mr. Bella, do you want me to accept this sentence agreement?
Okay, now that I didn't know.
If I answer the court's question, I would like an opportunity to discuss it with the victim's family.
Okay.
If the court would pass it, I would appreciate it.
Be happy to do that. We'll pass this matter.
It's now up to the prosecution to decide whether or not to dismiss the agreement and pursue a trial.
I have had a very lengthy discussion with the victim's mother as well as his grandparents and some family members. They understand that obviously this is the defendant who brutally murdered their son by shooting him in the back of the head.
He's
shown absolutely no remorse. However, the Klee family does want to move on with this. They want to get some closure from this case. They want to try and forgive this defendant and all of his actions for what he did. And they are asking, as well as the people, that you proceed with the sentence.
Okay.
Wright has another opportunity to address the court, this time through his attorney.
Your Honor, my client asked me to apologize to the court. His smiling was in no way meant as disrespectful either to the family, to the victim, or to this court. My client is 17 years old. He has some emotional problems and frankly was scared. And some people display fear by smiling. He really meant no disrespect. He does take this very seriously, and I think he does feel bad about it.
The judge accepts the sentencing agreement, which puts him behind bars for 25 to 52 years.
I'm sorry for acting immature on the road. I understand that, you know, being on the road, you could have other people's lives in your hand. And, you know, I should have thought about that.
When defendant Cyrus Matthews was there on misdemeanor charges stemming from a road rage case.
As well as, is there, like, any way that we could reverse his jail time?
Well, you're going to go to jail today. You need to get out of here.
You just walked away. Like, you're not supposed to do that. He literally ran out the building. You're not supposed to do that.
There seems to be a moment of hesitation here on Matthew's part. We now know it's the bailiff trying to reason with him, explaining that his escape will lead to felony charges. To no avail.
Oh my God.
Police take over. Matthews is way ahead, reaching speeds of up to 90 miles an hour.
That's fast.
Officer James Walzer is receiving updates. SUV seen just off the road there.
Dang.
Where's he at?
That's Matthew's car there.
All right, we're gonna have multiple vehicles, airbag deployment. Sam, are you okay? Okay.
The passengers are a couple and their infant child.
She's okay. All right, we got squads coming.
Thankfully, they have non-life-threatening injuries. Mm. Hustles over towards Matthew's car across the road. You can hear that Matthews realizes he's made a truly horrible decision. Matthews and his girlfriend are extracted by the Wadsworth Police Department and taken to the hospital. Matthews is charged with aggravated felonious assault for injuring his girlfriend and the occupants of the other vehicle. He's sentenced to 425 days in jail.
Shoots at the 20 days in jail.
Joining me now is the bailiff that you saw there on that video. Sharon Ray, thank you very much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
What were you saying to him to try to get him not to leave?
Dan, what we were trying to say is just don't make a permanent decision based on temporary circumstances. And I told him if he went back into the courtroom, it was going to be okay. But a felony follows you for a life, and that's going to dramatically change your life.
For a second there, it looked like you'd convinced him to go back to the courtroom.
I thought I had him. But the girlfriend came out of the courtroom, and when she did, he said, come on, let's go. And she followed him. And I remember saying to her, if you care for him at all, you'll get him back in there. And they didn't stop. They ran for the car and took off.
Why was it such a bad idea for him to run?
because he would have gone to jail for 60 days. And because of what he did, he ended up being convicted of aggravated felonious assault, and he went to jail for 425 days.
He probably wishes that he had listened to you.
Right.
I think he does. I wish he'd listened to me, too.
Was his girlfriend injured?
She was injured. She was in the car with him. I believe they did use the jaw of life to get her out, and she did have some surgeries. I have not kept up on where she is now or what she's doing.
You don't know?
If she still is.
I was just going to ask you, do you know if they're still together?
I do not. I do not. I'm sure it put a dent in the relationship.
Thanks for being a fan of Court Cam. Subscribe to A&E to never miss a new video and catch full episodes on AETV.com.
All I have to say about this is, you guys, if you're in middle school and high school and you have a friend that does something stupid like this, just say no and call Uber and go home, or call your parents and say, hey, look, I'm in a situation where they're about to do something stupid still, something out of a store. You guys think smart. Like, go to school. Get your education. Get a diploma. Don't hang out with people that you think they're your friends and they say, hey, come on, let's go rob a store. Just say no. Because you're going to end up at the wrong place at the wrong time. And, yeah, like, comment, share, and subscribe, KL Squad. Hit that post notification bell so you can be one of the members of the KL Squad family. And, yeah, bye.